Filzah binti Alia. So I'm a dietitian in Encik Besar Ajar Kasum. And today I will be presenting CFP on enhanced recovery after surgery. Okay, this is from some literature review I did. So we found that 80% of a patient undergoing major surgery are usually malnourished. So you know, when you are introducing, you put patient on surgery, it will introduce to catabolic stress to the body. So if patient have low muscle mass, so it will cause them to experience critical muscle loss, and it will increase also the risk of morbidity, functional independence, and mortality post-operatively. Okay, so this is also a literature review we found in 2018. This is majorly from for gastrointestinal surgery. So we found that 2 out of 3 patients coming for GI surgery are malnourished at the time of surgery. So this malnourished patient will experience 3 times greater risk of having complication, and also 5 times more likely to die than well-nourished patient post-operatively. And they also found that 1 in 5 hospital in former hospital have former screen nutrition screening process, and 3 out of 4 surgeons believe that peri-operative nutrition delivery will reduce complication post-operatively. And also every dollar spent on nutrition therapy in hospitalized patient will save around $52 in hospital costs in terms of admission and other treatments. And they also found that only 1 out of 5 patients receive pre-op nutrition intervention. So this is very important as well. Okay, so the principle of metabolic and nutritional care is the key component of ERAS. Okay, so ERAS is actually aims to reduce pre-operative stress. Second one is to condition the metabolic risk. It may involve multidisciplinary consultation such as physician, NS, and also physiotherapists, dietitians, nurses, and also pharmacists. And it's also a tri-model approach where it includes nutrition, physical exercise, and stress-reducing psychological component. And it involves multidisciplinary team, right? So these are the components of ERAS protocol. We have 22 components, okay? But I've seen in literature that not every components are being adapted. This is the suggested or the recommended one, okay? So the most important thing, the most important thing is the pre-admission counseling, because when patient going for elective surgery, usually the diagnosis and also screening will be done in the clinic. So this will be the first line of intervention is actually doctors. Okay. Because you will diagnose the patient, right? And then suddenly we also found that if, let's say, we meet patient in the clinic, we diagnose them, we told them, makcik, you're going for surgery for satu atau 2 bulan lagi. So psychologically, that patient, even though it's not, for us, it's not something yang macam, maybe macam sikit-sikit, kita nak investigate je, but to patient, because they are being at the receiving end, so sometimes they feel scared. So bila balik, kita tak ada screening or anything, kita rasa macam makcik ni okey je. And then balik, dia akan jadi health conscious. Bila jadi health conscious, indirectly dia macam, oh ni takutlah nak makan ni, takutlah nak makan tu. Sometimes they will lose appetite because of kadang-kadang dia rasa depressed ataupun rasa macam sedih kenapa dia dapat sakit tu. Kan? So sometimes kita overlook this sebab kita rasa makcik, okay, kita jumpa lagi 3 bulan, kita bagi lagi TCA 1 bulan. Tapi bila kita jumpa kat klinik, tapi balik rumah, patient actually experience those kind of like macam depressive moods lah, ataupun dia sedih. Sometimes dia rasa macam lost appetite, that is actually interlinked. So this is very important for us to screen patient at the clinic, okay? And also there's a phase dekat at clinic where we have to optimize their metabolic comorbidities. Kalau ada patient diabetes ke, kalau ada hypertension or patient smoking ke, usually we'll counsel patient to smoking cessation, right? Prior to op. Okay? And then also kita akan juga buat nutrition screening kat sini. Kalau boleh buat optimization kat rumah, kita buat kat rumah. Kalau severe malnourished, usually we'll admit the patient and optimize dekat ward lah. Alright? So dekat ward admission phase, there will be a fluid and carbohydrate loading. And also we don't want to fast our patient for so long. Okay? And then so some no or selective bowel preparation for different types of surgery, antibiotic prophylaxis, thromboprophylaxis, and no premedication. This is the suggestion by ERAS protocol. Okay, so intraoperative, usually dietitian is not involved. So this one is actually surgeon, nurses, and also NS. This NS plays a important role during this part. Okay, the recommendation is actually the maintenance of normothermia, avoidance of salt and water overload. This is the fluid targeted therapy, right? And also no drains, and also mid thoracic epidural anesthesia or analgesia. Okay, post operatively, this will involve a lot of multidiscipline, right? So including NS, surgeons, physiotherapists, nurses, dietitians, okay. Right, so the recommendation is the mid thoracic epidural anesthesia and also no nasogastric tubes if it's not applicable. Some kita akan letak nasogastric tubes ni, from my reading, is only for kalau kita nak ambil aspirations, kata gastric aspiration study. Prevention of nausea and vomiting, avoidance of salt and water overload. Early removal of catheter as early as day post-op day 1. Early oral nutrition as early as 6 hours post-op. Non-oral analgesia. Early mobilization as early as 8 hours post-operation. Stimulation of gut motility is from clear fluids. And also audit. This is important also lah. Audit of compliance and outcome. Sometimes, let's say we do improve patient's outcome through ERAS, but we don't audit that effort that we do. How are we gonna? How are we gonna value ourselves on what we do? Okay, adakah apa yang kita buat terkesan untuk pesakit? Adakah selamat? Adakah ada komplikasi? So this is important lah. Okay, right. So we have three phases. Pre, intra, and post-op. So, like what I explained just now, the pre-hospital is actually the counseling in the clinic. So, this is a very important phase, because kalau you nak optimize patient during the day of surgery, admission to is too late already. Okay? So, this is very important for us to, to screen patient in the clinic. Okay? Alright? Okay, so I also want to highlight on the sarcopenia. Sarcopenia can happen in obese patient as well. Okay, so it's a malnutrition associated with increased risk of post-operative complications. This is sarcopenia. Alright, so we as a normal human being, tak sakit apa, tak ada apa. So we also have to take care of ourselves. Sebab by the time we are 30 and above, every year we lose 1% of our muscle mass. So kalau tak ada buat exercise, kalau kita very sedentary, we lose it even though kita muda. Okay? So kalau you lose your muscle mass, kalau perasan, kalau patient kan, datang-datang dekat hospital, actually boleh jalan lagi. Lepas tu bila dah buat op ke apa ke, dia dah bad bounce, sakit terus terbaring. Dia tak boleh buat apa-apa dah. So that one is actually, kita panggil ni muscle wasting lah. Alright? So, major surgery and stress will induce catabolism and worsen the outcome of surgery. This patient is malnourished. So, this is the, pathway lah, altered metabolism in prolonged starvation, if let's say we starve the patient for too long, or patient is actually involuntarily going for starvation. Sebab sometimes kan kalau pesakit ni, kalau dia sakit, sometimes dia tak ada selera makan. Kita pun kalau demam pun tak rasa nak makan. Betul tak? Makan sikit je. So like, apa lagi kalau patient yang very, orang kata apa, ada chronic diseases ke apa ke kan, sometimes psikologi juga support tak ada. So they will macam akan makin teruk lah. Okay. So will cause hyperglycemia, insulin resistant. That will also leads to insulin resistant, that will also leads to the protein catabolism. That's why yang kita akan hilang masa kalau kita, orang kata apa, staff lah. Sebab body nak compensate that energy, they will use the kalau tak dapat energy yang cukup, dia akan nak pakailah kita punya otot untuk feed us, right? Okay, so ERAS actually started off as a colorectal surgery lah, in colorectal surgery. But now kita dah banyak disiplin yang kita pakailah. It's either bariatric boleh, vascular, even ortho, gynecology punya surgery. So kat sini lah ada banyak. Okay. So even emergency laparotomy pun ada ERAS. Usually dulu kita rasa macam ERAS is for only for elective surgery. But now emergency surgery pun ada guideline dia. Alright. Okay. So the pre-admission phase, these are the things that we can screen lah at the clinic. So the first one is functional status. Kita boleh tengok patient punya ECOG, and then so walking distance test, incentive spirometry and also peak flow. Kalau nutrition status, we can see the weight, BMI and subjective global assessment. Okay, sebab weight and BMI ni actually dia fluctuate. Sebab sometimes kalau orang yang obese, macam saya cakap tadi, BMI tu tinggi tapi actually dia tak doing well pun, sebab dia low muscle mass. Okay. So kalau patient, sebab tu kita ambil yang kita buat juga subjective global assessment ni. Kalau stable, optimization at home. Kalau severe malnourished, kita optimize dekat ward. And also serum albumin and TLC, this is the pre-operative risk stratification untuk post-operative clinical outcome. Tapi kita tak ada serum albumin. Kita ada serum albumin. Pre-albumin, if I'm not mistaken. Serum albumin kot kita ada. Tapi dia tak spesifik lah. And it's affected by alteration in homeostasis such as inflammation. So kita punya assessment of kalau kata patient tu malnourished, should not be dependent on albumin sahaja. Should go together with multimodal lah. So maksudnya kita tengok oriented patient tu, history dia ada weight loss ke tak, semua apa, baru kita boleh guna together with the serum albumin, mengatakan patient tu malnourished. Okay. Alright, so there are several malnutrition screening tool. Kita ada malnutrition universal screening tool, MUST. This is for community. And also kita ada nutrition risk screening, NRS 2002, yang ni kita pakai kat hospital. And also mini nutrition assessment, MNA, for elderly or geri lah, geriatric. Okay, so now actually kat hospital, dekat surgical ward, kita implement sekarang, kita pakai adapted from this NRS lah, kita ada buat. Alright, so for malnutrition, this is for malnutrition screening only. For diagnosis, kita akan pakai SGA, and also Global Leadership Initiative on Malnutrition, GLIM. Alright, so this is the NRS. Usually kita akan screen lah macam BMI less than 20.5 ke tak. Kalau less than 20.5 pun dah kira satu tick yes. Okay, so if the answer is yes to any questions yang empat ni, kita terus pergi ke table 2. Table 2, this one, kita akan tengok lah patient ni, dia normal nutrition status ke. Kalau normal, kosong lah. Tapi kalau dia ada contoh weight loss, at least more than 5% within 3 months, terus dah ada satu score. And also kalau patient ada comorbidities macam COPD, okay, chronic patient, macam liver cirrhosis ke apa ke, terus ada score kat sini. Okay, kalau ada nak pernah buat major surgery atau stroke, 2 dah score. Okay, so kita tengok kat sini lah. Kalau BMI less than 15.5, terus score 3. Kalau and also kalau if age more than 70, tambah lagi satu score. So score lebih daripada 3, kita terus kena ada intervention lah, nutrition intervention. Okay, so this is the MUST screening. Okay, and then so MNA. And also kalau for nutrition diagnosis, you can use GLIM lah. Masa screening tu, you can use the NRS ataupun MUST ke MST. And then during the assessment criteria, kita tengok phenotypic dengan etiologi. Kalau contoh dia ada low body mass index and also reduced food intake, dia kena ada salah satu. These two, phenotypic ada satu, etiologi ada satu, and then you can diagnose the malnutrition already. Okay? Alright. So, and then severity of grading ni, kita can use SGA. Okay? So, this is 7-point subjective global assessment, which is senang je nak isi. Sebab kita just macam tanya diri kita je. Contoh yang first tu, weight loss ada tak dalam masa 6 bulan? Berapa persen? And then dietary intake for the past 2 week tu ada kurang ke tak? And then kita terus boleh grade berapa? 6 ke 5 ke 4 ke? And GI symptoms ada tak masalah? Kalau macam ada some symptom, ada sip birit ke apa ke? Functional status kena tengok. Ada hilang stamina ke? Macam nak pergi tandas pun rasa semput ke apa ke? You can actually great lah. Then next, ada metabolic demand tak? Dia macam ada uncontrolled diabetic ke apa ke, masa wasting mal tu moderate ke. Then fat stores, kita boleh tengok secara fizikal. Nanti saya tunjuk macam mana kita nak tengok fat stores dia. And also edema. Kalau kata contoh dia ada bengkak-bengkak kaki ke apa, kita boleh great juga. And then, kita tak payah tambah semua. Kita just tengok average. Average yang dekat daripada soalan-soalan yang tanya tu, grade dia dekat berapa? Kalau dia dekat 3 dengan 5, maksudnya dia adalah mild to moderately malnourished. Kalau dia banyak grade dekat sini, 1 hingga 2 ni, maksudnya dia severely malnourished. Okay? Alright, so this is the, saya kata physical nutrition, nutrition focus physical examination. Okay? So kita boleh tengok masa wasting dekat apa yang lower body. Subcutaneous fat loss, contoh macam dekat orbital fat pads, tricep, and also kita punya anterior low ribs. And also kita boleh tengok fluid status, edema, ascites or anasaka. Okay, banyak kan patient kita macam ni. So you can see dekat temples, kan usually tengok patient yang going for op ke apa ke, yang elderly ke, usually they will have macam cengkung kan dekat dia punya temples tu. Lepas tu kita boleh tengok dekat deltoids. Yang ni ramai tak perasan. Tapi kalau tengok patient yang dulu dia okay, lepas tu dia makin tua, dia akan nampak dekat dia punya deltoids ni akan nampak macam wasting. And also you can see dekat scapula and enterosus, muscle dekat tangan. Even kat tangan sometimes kalau orang kurus kan, dia memang tak ada isi kat tengah tu. Kalau tengok orang tua kan memang tak ada isi. Okay. And also clavicles lah, ni paling obvious. Sometimes kita boleh tengok juga dekat mata. Sometimes kalau tengok patient yang very keketsi, dia akan macam bulging sikit mata dia. Okay, ni kalau tak cukup tidur lain lah dia punya apa tu, ni kan. And also you can see dekat tricep lah. Okay, alright. So these are alternative nutrition assessment you can tengok. Selain pada kita tanya patient dia turun berat ke apa ke tak kan, so kita boleh tengok benda ni juga, fat stores dia. Okay, ni anterior low ribs, banyak kan patient kita yang macam ni. Kan, so usually kalau patient yang macam ni very malnourished, kita kena ada intervention lah at least. Okay. And also ni lah skin tegur, you boleh tengok. Okay. Right, measurement of frailty kita boleh pakai frailty, grip strength, exhaustion, low physical activity and slow walking speed. Even kalau contoh kan kita tengok weakness, hand grip tu kurang, yang tarik tu kan, kurang daripada 5.83 tu untuk lelaki, kalau perempuan 3.37. Kalau kurang betul maksudnya patient memang very frail. Bayangkan dia tak boleh even nak pegang barang yang 3 kilo. Kan kalau tarik tu macam tak kuat. Sebabnya itu hand grip tu boleh tengok jugalah patient kadang-kadang yang kalau kita pakai spirometry tu, even patient tak boleh tiup pun. Satu bola pun tak naik. Alright? Okay. Kalau ikut yang measurement yang frailty ni, kalau 3 criteria present, dah frail maksudnya. Okay? Okay, so preoperative nutrition support should be initiated if kita anticipate the patient will be unable to eat for more than 5 perioperative ni maksudnya sebelum, okay, atau selepas. Okay, so it's indicated for patient with low oral intake and cannot maintain above 50 of the recommendation for more than 7 days. Kebanyakan patient yang saya jumpa dekat hospital memang tak boleh maintain above 50. Unless kalau patient tu actually well, cuma dia takut-takut nak makan, tu yang kita boleh lah. Tapi sometimes yang memang low intake ni memang kita kena bagi ONS lah, initiate oral nutrition supplement or tube feeding. So, kita akan preferably by enteral lah, either oral ataupun tube. Okay, so period of optimization is 7 to 14 days, may be appropriate for nutrition therapy optimization. Okay, so the enteral route mestilah selalu di prefer unless kalau dia ada contraindication lah. Contoh kalau ada intestinal obstruction ke, ileus ke, high output fistula ke, macam tu lah. And then combination of parenteral and enteral nutrition is recommended if requirement cannot be met via oral or enteral intake less than 50% of recommended intake for 7 days. Kalau contoh enteral dia boleh ambil sikit je, around 30%. So kita kena support the other part with PM. Alright? So this is the flowchart lah for preoperative nutrition support therapy. So first screening, kalau low risk, mungkin kita boleh start oral nutrition therapy. Energy needs dia boleh sampai tak dengan oral nutrition? Kalau tak, kita akan bagi kata apa, ONS lah, ataupun immuno-ONS. ONS ni yang fortified dengan contoh EPA ataupun arginine, those kind of things. Okay? Alright, so natural diet can be supplemented with the aid of liquids diet, ONS. Okay? So, kalau there's a presence of specific medical needs, kalau dia inadequate oral intake, maksudnya oral solids tu dia tak makan banyak, kita boleh bagi melalui ONS melalui mulut lah. Okay? No altered sensorium and also no risk of aspiration and no defective swallowing mechanism. Ni kalau patient tak sedar, macam tak, bukanlah tak sedar, macam dia tak aware dekat mana, dementia ke apa ke, sometimes we ada risk of aspiration lah dekat patient-patient macam tu. Alright? So when to prescribe ONS? Anything less than 50 to 75% of daily requirement. Patient oral intake, makan tak habis, support dengan ONS. Okay? Crucial role of dietitian to assess risk, through diet recall lah. Tapi currently we are actually lacking of manpower, so it's actually good for you guys to know this. Okay? Okay? Alright, so full enteral nutrition, or kalau dekat sini kita panggil polymeric diet. So it can be through tube or oral. Okay? It's kalau per oral, kita boleh bagi patient to full liquid diet ataupun full polymeric ni kalau patient tu cooperative and understand the requirement lah. So, sama juga kalau dia tak ada altered sensorium, no risk of aspiration or no defective swallowing mechanism. Kita akan pakai enteral tube kalau patient tak cooperative. Contoh kita bagi prescribe, pakcik tak minum pun ataupun pakcik tak boleh nak habiskan. So, kita akan pakai tube untuk support lah. Okay? Okay, so if oral intake is not possible lah, tak kisahlah solids ke ataupun ONS ke, early EN ni kena perform initially in critically adult patient rather than early PN sebab kita nak maintain gut mortality. Mortality pula. gut ni, integrity, sorry. Gut integrity. Okay? Alright? So, kita tak nak nanti kalau sebab kita lama sangat keep patient on PN, dia punya gut tu tak function. Sebab tahu kan kita punya gut ni actually, kata apa? Kita punya immunity punya tempat jugalah macam tu pun. Okay, so in case of contraindication to oral and EN, PN should be implemented within 3 to 7 days. Ni recommended je, tapi kalau kita dah nampak dah memang contraindication, first day, second day dah boleh start. Okay, alright. So preoperative phase, so carbohydrate loading and no prolonged fasting. So kita tak nak unnecessary preoperative fasting lah. So clear fluids are allowed up to 2 hours and solid 6 hours before anesthesia. And clear fluid empty stomach within 60 to 90 minutes. So tak ada isu sangat lah. Okay, tak ada risk of kata apa, aspiration. Okay, tapi exception lah. for this recommendation for patient at special risk, emergency surgery or delayed gastric emptying lah. Okay, so this is the carbohydrate loading punya kita panggil apa protocol. So currently we don't have resource in this hospital. We have kabori. Tapi kabori ni patient kena minum banyak sikit. Sebab dia akan the night before operation ni 10 hingga 12 lah. Tapi malam ni actually pukul 8 pun boleh start. 50 grams of kabori in 400 ml water. Sebab kita nak dapat consistency of 12.5% of carbohydrate ni. Okay. So dia kena minum 2 sachet. So maksudnya 800 ml dia kena minum malam before. And pagi before operation 2 jam tu pukul 6 pagi kan, schedule pukul 8, 400 ml juga. Kalau resource ni senang sikit sebab air dia sikit je dalam 200 ml. So patient boleh hanya perlu minum malam tu 400 ml, pagi 200 je. Yang ni volume dia besar sikit sebab dia nak dapatkan consistency of carbohydrate tu 12.5%. Okay? Alright, so carbohydrate loading and also diabetes. Ni kalau usually kita boleh maybe implemented in those type 2 DM without increased risk lah for intra and post-operative hyperglycemia or surgical complication. Okay, so summary of fasting recommendation. Kalau clear liquids 2 hours prior to op. Kalau kalau ni kalau macam ada PITS punya surgery lah, breast milk and infant formula, breast milk 4 hours, infant formula 6 hours. Kalau non-human milk ni macam cow's milk kan, 6 hours. Light meal 6 hours. Okay? Alright. So intraoperative macam saya cakap tadi, prevention of hypothermia, active warming, minimally invasive surgery where possible to minimize tissue handling and exposure. Hemodynamic optimization via goal directed fluid therapy and also nasogastric intubation only for gastric aspirate study and immediate post op feeding. Okay? Post-operatively, prevention of post-operative nausea vomiting, maintenance of oxygen after operation, and so kita boleh kira post-operative nausea vomiting ni pakai full score and minimal administration of opiates. Okay, so DVT prophylaxis ni ada orang kata apa, compression stocking and also orang kata apa, prophylaxis lah. Okay, post-operative glucose control. Ni kita kena tengok jugalah, sometimes patient dekat ward dia GM post-operative tak berapa okey kan, so kita kena monitor. Early removal of catheter and drainage as early as post-op day 1 whenever possible for selected patient. Early mobilization tadi 8 hours after surgery. Okay, prevention of prolonged ileus, no opiates, restrictive fluid therapy, maintain urine output in the first 24 hours, 1 ml/kg per hour, early oral feeding or trophic feeding, to combine total volume, feeding and maintenance of IV fluid equal to full requirement lah of fluid, and also always to prepare cut down volume each time calorie atau feeding increase. Janganlah kita increase feeding, IV kita tak sama macam tu, okay? Alright? So post-operative nutrition therapy, ni lah kita just macam orientate boleh achieve management according to ERAS protocol. Kalau ada complication kita boleh pakai NJ, NG ataupun ni lah. Then nutrition therapy EN, kalau less than 15 days kita akan bagi supplementary parenteral nutrition. Calorie dapat achieve, dietary counselling, ONS. Consider juga EN kalau kata patient tak boleh nak achieve, and then kita discharge. Alright, so post-operatively, oral intake including clear liquids shall be initiated hours after surgery in most patients. Should be adapted to the state of gastrointestinal function and also individual tolerance. Sometimes, kita start clear fluid, kita bagi kat patient 6 hours post-op, patient muntah. Janganlah paksa. Okay, tak ada macam pakcik kena juga minum. Tak adalah, kalau pakcik muntah, janganlah paksa dia. Okay. Alright, early EN within 24 hours shall be initiated in patient whom early oral nutrition cannot be started. In whom oral intake will be inadequate 50% for more than 7 days. So usually ni macam major head and neck surgery ataupun severe trauma including brain injury or obvious malnutrition at the time of surgery. Okay, so enteral nutrition therapy post-operatively kita boleh pakai standard whole protein formula is appropriate lah mostly. Okay, so kita start low rate lah dekat around 10 to 20 ml. This is trophic feeding And then kita akan increase gradually, may take 5 to 7 days to achieve target intake. Okay, immunomodulation formula, ini ada arginine, omega 3, ribonucleotides, okay? Given peri ataupun peri pula. Sorry, ni pre. Maksudnya sebelum operation 5 hari kita bagi, and then post-operative. Tapi dekat hospital ni kita tak ada immunoformula lah. Okay? Right, so kita ada polymeric formula. Ini composed of intact protein requiring a functioning GI tract for absorption and digestion. Kalau patient ada malabsorption, janganlah bagi polymeric formula. Nanti patient tak tolerate. Okay? Right, elemental formula, partially or completely hydrolyzed micronutrients. Yang ni kita ada partially sahaja, which is peptamen lah. May have unpleasant odor and taste. Yang ni jangan, usually avoid to suruh patient minum orally sebab dia dah pre-digested. Dia cepat sikit. Okay, so we don't, kita tak ada elemental formula lah. Okay, model formula, ini untuk supplemental use. Contoh macam additional calories or protein, contoh MCT oil, carbori or myotin. Sebab dia adalah single macronutrients. Kalau MCT ni fat only. Kalau carbori is only glucose. Myotin is protein. This is specific specialty formula, specific organ dysfunction or metabolic stress. Contoh macam kidney issue. Okay. So yang ni polymeric formula kita ada banyak lah. Sekarang kita ada produk baru. Sekarang kita pakai dia tak ada enakal. Kita ada pakai Nutritional Optimum and also Phonative Complete. Okay. And also sekarang kita ada ready to drink untuk standard formula, tapi saya hanya limitkan untuk patient cardio. Sebab patient cardio yang poor oriented kan dia ada ROF. So kita pakai yang ni lah. Okay. Alright. Polymeric formula, fiber supplemented. Kalau patient diarrhea atau sembelit, we can use this one lah. Okay, nutrient fiber je lah yang kita ada. Tapi good to know, kita ada juga isosol and also gelatin in other hospital. Alright? Okay, elemental formula, semi-elemental formula. This partially lah, elemental formula kita ada peptamen only. Yang ni RTD dah tak ada lah. Sebab kita punya penggunaan sangat perlahan, so kita tak purchase. Okay? So this is for impact GI motility, motility, maldigestion and malabsorption. Okay, kalau modular formula, ni lah yang kita ada, myotin, carbori and also MCT. Okay, this is specific condition specific. Kita ada Novasource for renal lah. Okay, this is for renal patient. Okay, and the energy dense, low in electrolytes. Okay, acute or chronic renal failure ataupun ada hypernatremia or hyperphosphatemia. Okay, ni diabetic lah. Diabetic sama tahu kan, tapi nutrient diabetic dah tukar nama eh. Nutrient glucose balance, yang ni kita pakai sekarang. Another one kita ada phonative diabetes, tapi belum pakai lagi. Yang RTD, so far kita ada nutrient diabetes plus. Tapi yang ni pun kita restrict for cardio patient yang ada ROF and diabetic. Okay. Right, so this is for cancer, immunonutrition lah. Kita ada brochure sebab kita suggest untuk patient cancer yang buat chemo sebab dia perlukan this EPA lah, fish oil. Kita ada supportan, oral impact and also brochure. Tapi tiga-tiga ni kita tak ada kat hospital ni. Okay, unless kalau ada samples lah. Okay, so kita safe delivery for enteral feeding, small amount, slow feeding on any polymeric formula. Continuous rather than bolus EN should be used lah. Yang ni strong consensus. Tapi sometimes sebab kita tak cukup pump feeding, usually kita akan start bolus as soon as possible. For the safety of patient, prevent refeeding syndrome, improve gut tolerance and also prevent wastage of resources. Okay, so careful delivery. Kita tak nak nanti macam masalah aspiration lah. Okay. So kita boleh pakai continuous, cyclic or bolus. So difference between cyclic and bolus ni, jap. Ni, okay. Continuous feeding memang 24 hours lah. Selalu dekat ICU kita pakai 24 hours. Okay. Tapi dia kena bancuh every 4 hours. Sebab dia tak boleh bancuh banyak. Sebab and then gantung semua lebih daripada 8 jam. Sebab dia punya hang time tu 4 hours only. Sebab after 4 hours, bakteria akan tumbuh lah kat dalam susu tu. So nanti masuk cik birit pula. Okay, cyclic feeding selalunya cyclic or intermittent feeding ni kita akan rest. Ada beberapa hours yang kita akan rest lah. And then bolus feed, macam biasalah, kita bagi 10 minit, lepas tu 3 jam kemudian kita bagi lagi. Eh, alamak. Belum lagi, belum habis. Sekejap eh. Ah ni. So this is the difference lah between continuous and cyclic feeding. And also intermittent feeding lah. Okay, apa tu? Kalau cyclic feeding ni dia macam ada nocturnal feeding tu, dia tak bagilah. Okay, intermittent feeding ni dia macam every 20 to 60 minutes. So kita bagi run 3 hours, rest 1 hour. Atau run 4 hours, rest 2 hour lah, macam tu. Kalau bolus feed, every 3 hours. Continuous feed, run 4 hours, 6 cycles per day. Tapi dia kena bancuh setiap 4 jam. Eh, sebab dia punya hang time tu. Itu yang saya risau sebab takut nanti susu basi. Okay, alright. Alright, so ni sama lah macam tadi eh. Kalau oral intake tak okay, less than 50% PN should be supplemented lah. Okay, so kita ada PN, ada all in one, 3-chamber bag, ataupun ada yang compounded. Okay, so PN 45 with omega 3 fatty acid is preferred post-operatively. Okay, so kita ada sekarang ni, ni lah. So before kita nak decide which bag kita nak pakai, kena kira non-protein calorie, nitrogen and non-protein calorie, nitrogen ratio. Kalau patient tu severely stressed, dia punya tu mesti ni lah, kalau pengiraan dia 80 nisbah 1 is severely stressed. Kalau 100 to 1 moderate stress, and also 150 to 1 is unstressed patient. So this is the things yang kita kena consider before kita pilih what kind of bag we're going to use. Okay? So this is the, orang kata apa, sikit lah pasal macronutrients punya calculation and PN. Kalau nak detail nanti PN tepi, okay? Ataupun tanya Mr. Ngor ataupun Abby lah, kita punya PN pharmacist. So kita ada central vein dengan peripheral vein. Apa beza dia? Dia punya osmolarity. Sebab kalau kita bagi yang central vein, boleh hold higher osmolarity punya TPN. Kalau kita bagi TPN yang supposed to be in central vein dekat peripheral, salah. So kena hati-hati, okay? Alright. Okay, so this is the compounded one. Selalunya kita akan, selalu dekat ICU ada pakai. Sebab kita tengok based on sometimes patient ada renal issue, kan dia tak boleh pakai yang ready to hang punya bag tu yang dah siap. So kena buat satu-satulah, kena kira satu-satu apa orang kata apa electrolytes yang kita tak nak atau kita nak reduce. Okay, alright. So position space, pack tube, okay, dekat sini saya jarang nampak is indicated actually for long term EN. Most probably because mahal, cost lah nak buat tu kan. Tapi actually kalau kita dah tahu patient tu prolong on tube, better pakai pad. Sebab dia akan, nanti akan irritate patient punya, kata apa, nasal cavity semua apalah. Okay, alright. So continuation of nutrition support therapy including qualified dietary counselling after discharge, still do not cover, kata apa, kita kena continue lah. Even patient dah discharge pun, sometimes dia akan still lose weight. So even after discharge pun kita kena still tanya, makcik makan okey ke tak, macam mana, okay? Alright, so these are my references. Soalan ke?